just heard there's a cobra in a house.
Yeah,
it's right over here.
Oh, shit.
Oh, there it is. 100,000 people die every year, and it's caused by the rain.
Absolutely.
There's a deadly connection between snakes and weather.
These two vials of anti-venom are going into this patient right now.
This is the desperate search for a new way to save lives.
Look at the friends. Look at the venom.
Around the world.
Well, last week we had a black mamba bite.
And in your backyard. This is SnakeStorm.
Palita is our driver here through the island of Sri Lanka. Traffic is one danger here, but there is another danger. You saw that snake we pulled out of the house.
One, two, three.
Have you ever had a cobra inside your house?
Yeah, yeah.
That's just a normal thing around here.
Yeah, yeah.
But the problem is they don't have an anti-venom specifically for the snakes on this island nation. That is, until now.
Sri Lanka is this raindrop-shaped island just off the east coast of India. Its rich history stretches back into ancient times, and much of the ancient world is still alive here as well. This nation of 20 million people is one of the snake bite capitals of the world. Venomous snakes kill more than 1,000 people here each and every year. Worldwide, it's around 100,000 people, and it's all connected to the weather. When it rains, snakes bite people. This is where it happens. There are deadly snakes right down there next to those farm workers.
Right over there?
Yeah,
rice is the most important crop in all of Sri Lanka. But every time these farm workers slice into the weeds, they are risking their life.
So you've seen Russell's vipers around here?
Yes.
They're more venomous than a cobra.
This guy is nasty. He is the deadly Russell's viper, named for the Scottish reptile expert that first described this killer snake back in the 1700s. Each time rainwater brings rice, the Russell's viper slithers out of the mud.
That's when they can get stung.
Snake expert Roy Maliapa got us face to face with the aggressive reptile.
I'm seriously sweating here, with all that you've told me about the Russell's viper.
Russell's viper is not only aggressive with his big fangs, he is also full of a complex venom that goes after not just your nervous system, but your blood at the same time.
You cannot trust this snake. Your eyes have always got to be.
I think I'm gonna step back anyway.
The danger is very real in the paddy fields. One wrong step, and families are torn apart.
We just walked about a half mile through this rustic path till we got to a very rural cemetery. You can see a lot of the monuments here have people's names on them. They've been here for years. But the story we're telling is the story of this unmarked grave here. The only reason why we know who lies here is because we know someone who went to the funeral. This is Chandima Dilani. She was 19 years old, killed by a Russell's viper while she was trying to bring her father some lunch.
We assume it was a Russell's viper because we see them all the time in rice paddy fields.
Yuji Hemawathi is the dead girl's mother. This is Chandima. She's been gone for years now, but that night is burned into her mother's memory.
They kept her at the hospital until midnight.
We cannot independently verify Sri Lankan medical records from 2010, but Yuji says the doctors did give her daughter, the 19-year-old art student, some kind of anti-venom that didn't seem to work. There were major complications and no way to transfer her to a larger hospital.
They said if we move her to another hospital, they can't take responsibility.
Here's what we know for sure. There is no one-size-fits-all anti-venom. For instance, a cobra bite in India is different than the venom from a cobra bite in neighboring Sri Lanka. At the time Chandima was bitten, the only anti-venom that would have been available would have been imported from India.
The snakes of India are not same to the snakes of Sri Lanka. So the anti-venoms of India have major complications. My name is Roy Maliapa. This is in Sri Lanka. This is at the Aviary Serpentarium in Dambul.
This is where Roy keeps all of his snakes, including that Russell's viper and some loudly hissing cobras. Roy's nonprofit team, Animal Venom Research International, or AVRI, are working on a way to fight snake bite deaths here.
So in order to get the best antivenom for Sri Lanka, we've got to make a new antivenom derived with snakes from Sri Lanka.
Right now, 2,500 experimental vials of the new antivenom are at a major hospital.
This patient just come in after the snake bite. So this, we've got this new antivenom, which has been in use for about 3 weeks now.
Even though my daughter was not saved, I'm happy the next generation will have a cure.
Too late for 19-year-old Chandima, but it seems to be working for the test patients. Meanwhile, here in the fields, angry snakes are still biting thousands of people per year. Some of them make it to the hospital. Some are lucky enough to get the Indian antivenom and survive. But as sure as rains will bring another snake bite, people will still die. Yet rain isn't coming like it used to.
After a long period of drought, when it rains, we see all kinds of snakes coming into our houses, on our land. They are far more active.
This is what she's talking about. This is how weather creates all of those snake bites in this region. It's a drought. You've got nothing in the aqueduct. It should be full of water, but my boot doesn't even sink in.
Snakes get very activated as soon as the rain comes.
So it seems we found an environmental scientist here in Sri Lanka.
This is Dr. Sadath Kadagama, former head of the University of Colombo's Environmental Science Department. He has spent decades studying birds and snakes and the environment and how they all interact with each other. Rain grows crops. After the rain, snakes go hunting right where people are harvesting.
And we have a lot of records. Generally turning up with people coming and saying, you know, we have a snake in our garden and things like that. Very related to these weather phenomena.
That's how Chandima died. She was bringing her father lunch on the still wet rice paddy, and bam, just after noon, that Russell's viper got her. In less than 12 hours, the healthy 19-year-old was on her deathbed.
This patient has been bitten by a hump-nosed viper bite.
Did they bring the snake in?
Yeah, he's brought the snake in.
So if you didn't have this new kind of anti-venom, how would you help this gentleman here?
If he didn't have, the treatment is limited.
Coming up right after this break here on SnakeStorm, we take you into the jungle and show you how the same venom that has brought death for thousands of years is now saving lives.
Whoa, look at that, look at this, look at that. Look at the way he's working his little fangs.
From those fangs to the IV bag, we are there as they test this new anti-venom that could save thousands of lives every year. We'll be right back. Sunrise. From just below the surface of water running through the jungle. Rain feeds this life-giving river, but rain can also bring destruction. Each day around the world, rains will wash venomous snakes from where they hide, and then on average, more than 200 people will die from a deadly encounter with a creature as ancient as Adam and Eve. Snake attacks happen all over the world, but not every country can afford their own antivenom. Imported antivenom isn't just expensive, it can be dangerous. Today, we're on a mission to find an inexpensive local alternative. We're traveling through the central highlands of Sri Lanka. We're on our way to Kandy. We are going to see the hospital where these clinical trials for the antivenom are underway. It's here at the University of Peradeniya where doctors and nurses are working day and night putting that new medicine to the test. Dr. Gowaramana.
Welcome. Let's
go. Thank you for having us here. Dr. Indica Gowaramana's toxicology ward is right down that open-air hallway to the left. We got there minutes after this man, a police officer, was rushed in with a venomous snake bite.
He's bitten on the left foot.
Oh, right here.
You can see there's swelling.
The off-duty officer was bitten in his garden by something called a hump-nosed viper, a small but toxic snake. This is what it can do to a finger. Hump-nosed venom can also shut down your kidneys. Just days ago, there was nothing doctors could do for a hump-nosed viper victim, other than a little pain relief.
He's about 23.
His feet are already starting to swell up. But he is lucky. He is one of the first patients to try this new experimental cure.
This is the antivenom that's currently in circulation throughout the hospitals on the clinical trials.
Right now, this is the only hospital with 2,500 vials of the new antivenom built for the snakes of Sri Lanka, including, for the first time, the hump-nosed viper. And it's working better than expected. This man in the waiting room is here with a painful cobra bite. There is antivenom for cobras, but it comes from India, where the venom is just different enough to cause a dangerous allergic reaction.
I think this is going to be definitely much better than the Indian antivenom.
And cheaper. In the United States, one vial of antivenom can cost more than $3,000. Sometimes you need 60 vials to cure one bite.
We can't compete for the developing world with those kind of costs.
These new vials, well, they cost less than $30. The venom that eventually becomes antivenom comes from these snakes at the AVRI Serpentarium, just 40 miles north of the hospital.
So in 20 minutes, he'll have not one, not two, but five.
Five, yeah.
All five in vials in
yes,
him.
Yeah.
When will he start feeling the reaction?
End of the infusion.
Snake bites and lack of access to cheap local antivenom kill an estimated 100,000 people every year around the world. And it's all connected to the weather.
When the climate is colder, they like to come closer to humans and stay closer to humans.
You see, snakes can't regulate their body temperature, so they're always looking for a warm place to hide. After a big rain, hospitals expect more venom victims.
So the best day to collect animals would be soon after a rain, after a long drought. Now we are having very prolonged dry spells. Or and when the rain comes, it is very heavy, in very short spells. So we believe that the predictions of these extremes in the weather is what we are seeing, and therefore maybe the climate change is affecting.
Long periods of drought followed by short bursts of rain that tend to wash snakes towards people. It's a change for this region, and it has already proven deadly. For environmental scientist Dr. Sadath Katagama, this pattern is something new.
I feel, and I know it, that the times of rains are very different.
For years, hospitals have been able to follow the weather patterns. Monsoon rains come twice a year, and with them, ambulances full of snake bite victims. That has all changed.
The hospitals need to be more in readiness in anticipation all the time, when in the past they were in anticipation with the monsoons and they knew this is going to be the time where you're going to have a lot of snake bites coming into the hospitals.
Back at the hospital, the police officer is already feeling better. In fact, the only reason why he can't go back on the beat today is because he's part of this experimental drug test.
When the trial is over and when we have the new antivenom available in this country, so this is what will happen. He'll get the infusion and he'll go home.
Doctors need to watch him and collect data. This new drug is in its very, very early stages. But if it works as well for others as it has for him, it could change the world.
This is revolutionary for you, isn't it?
I hope so. Yeah, I hope so.
At this point, you may be wondering if what happens here on the other side of the planet could help snake bite victims in your neighborhood in the United States.
But to tell that part of the story, we need to hop on a plane, take you nearly 10,000 miles from here, from one tropical city to another.
In the 80s, Crockett and Tubbs spent 111 episodes chasing drug kingpins off the streets of South Beach. in real life today, these are the heroes, the first responders of Miami. The brave men and women of Miami-Dade Fire Rescue not only run towards and into burning buildings, but they're also in charge of this refrigerator, full of anti-venom.
So this is about $6,000 for just one box.
South Florida, there is no place like it. Some of the craziest stories in America happen right here. Spend a day with the Miami-Dade Fire Department and you'll know exactly what I'm talking about. These teams are ready for anything. They actually have a dedicated snake bite unit. This is Venom 1.
It's a race against time tonight as doctors work to administer the correct amount of anti-venom to a teen who was bitten by a venomous water moccasin.
Not just when wild snakes bite people.
He didn't put the lid back on the cage.
But the exotic snakes bite people too.
Well, last week we had a black mamba bite.
Black mambas are native to sub-Saharan Africa. The bite was in Florida.
A couple weeks before that we had a Chinese moccasin.
Again, the bite happened in Florida.
We also had a king cobra bite right before Christmas.
Yes, a king cobra bit somebody in Florida, a state where you can legally own exotic animals if you have a permit. Medical researchers keep venomous snakes because, believe it or not, the venom has some potential life-saving uses. Zoos, of course, keep venomous snakes as well. But sometimes, even if you're an expert,
eventually, if you keep a snake, it's going to get you.
Todd Fassler lives in California and made the big mistake of touching one.
Hi, honey. Come on.
My toes were tingling. My body was tingling. Within 3 minutes of being bit, I was literally paralyzed.
Rattlesnakes are pit vipers. In the United States, this is the cure, an anti-venom called Crofab.
There's two vials in this one box, so this is about $6,000 for just one box.
There were three doctors and two nurses, and I think at the same time they were all injecting anti-venom in me.
Starting dose is anywhere from 4 to 6 vials, giving it as much as 60 vials on a bite.
They gave me 24 vials of anti-venom.
Many hospitals have that expensive anti-venom in stock. This is Todd Fassler's initial bill.
My total hospital bill was $153,000, with $83,000 for anti-venom alone.
BTG, the British company that makes Crofab, tells us their drug is fairly priced, citing the costs of research, development, FDA trials, marketing, and other factors. Experts tell us just bringing an anti-venom to market in the U.S. could cost a company upwards of $20 million. So right now, if a rattlesnake bites you, there's basically one choice.
This is the medicine you use.
Here in the U.S., a snake killing you or someone you love is virtually unheard of. That success is largely due to Crofab. The drug does its job and it saves lives. However, a few years back, some competitors popped up. BTG, the company that makes Crofab, they sued them claiming patent infringement. Those drug companies eventually settled out of court, but that did delay competition right here.
FDA-approved medicines are here, and from here, over is all the exotic anti-venoms.
But what happens if the snake is from the other side of the world?
She saw the snake literally crossing the road.
And the bite happens here in the United States.
Brent, you said you were shaking a little bit.
Of course, it's a venomous snake. It's not something we're used to every day.
In that case, Miami-Dade Venom 1 may have to charter a jet with the exotic medicine in a cooler.
Believe it or not, the stuff that you would think would be really expensive, like the king cobra anti-venom, only cost us around $60 a vial.
Victims in the U.S. do use anti-venoms from as far away as China, but they have to agree to use it as an experimental drug. Sometimes doctors use freeze-dried medicine that is technically past its expiration date.
It may not be as potent as it was when it was end date, so you may have to use a little more, but it still works.
The anti-venom project we have been following 10,000 miles away in Sri Lanka could eventually save lives where you live.
Because then we would bring that medicine and use for our keepers here in the United States.
And not for $5,000 a vial, but for less than $30 a vial, maybe as little as $25. But it won't work on U.S. snakes. Anti-venom is specific for the snake marked on the box. Some people think it's cool to keep exotic venomous snakes at home. This was Todd Fassler before the bite.
Yeah, he loves me. He loves me.
Here's Todd Fassler now.
What do I know now that I didn't know before the bite? Rattlesnakes are not pets.
You make one wrong move, you turn your back on them, that's when you're gonna get bit.
Vipers kill your skin and muscle tissue. Just a little bite will do this.
So where did you get bitten? Over here?
The kind of snake that bit her is the kind we are about to accidentally run into in the middle of the night.
Thank God we had the headlights on. Sean was observant.
That's when we return. During the break, you can follow us on Facebook and Twitter and look at our interactive map so you can see step by step our journey throughout this country. We'll be right back. Welcome to Talawa, Sri Lanka. This is a very rural town on this teardrop-shaped island nation just off the southeast coast of India. It's one of the world capitals for venomous snake bite. When that happens after a big rainstorm or a flooding event that pushes the snakes into someone's home or their village, well, there's not much they can do because there is no real local anti-venom here. But that's about to change. Late one night, on a bumpy jungle road, our driver saw something slither across the pavement.
This is a little hump-nosed viper with a fangs.
How in the world did you see that at night?
Sean did.
Sean saw that at night?
When we drive like we are looking for snakes.
They capture them alive, hoping to later collect the venom. You can already see it oozing over the snake stick.
Wow.
Look at the fangs. Look at the fangs.
Yeah.
It's biting into the thing. Look at that. Look at the venom.
Eventually, the venom will become anti-venom, a first-of-its-kind project in Sri Lanka.
Some people walk here, no shoes, middle of the night. Thank God we had the headlights on. Sean was observant.
Before this team came around, there hasn't been an anti-venom for the hump-nosed viper, the snake responsible for most of the bites here.
You're going to have a complication.
It can turn off your kidneys.
You can have renal failure with this little snake. Yes.
I still can't believe you saw that at night. That's nuts.
That's Roy Maliappa.
Let's put this thing in the bag.
He's not a doctor. In fact, he works in the construction industry in Pasadena, California.
I knew that I would not be able to make money being a herpetologist or any of that, so I went into a totally different career.
Roy's heart is here in his native Sri Lanka, where his team is working to develop a cheap, local anti-venom where it's needed, in homes like this in the developing world.
So where did you get bitten? Over here?
Yeah.
This is what a hump-nosed viper did to Malika Abewik Rama's finger.
You were digging in this firewood here? Just like really fast?
Oh, yeah.
How long were you in the hospital for this? You were in the hospital for a month and a week because of this one bite that just took a second.
Yeah.
At the time, and it wasn't so long ago, there was no anti-venom for this kind of bite. Now there is. Roy's experimental one we saw in action at the hospital. Extract the venom here, produce the anti-venom in Costa Rica, and then it's instantly ready for use.
We don't need FDA approval because none of these drugs are for the United States. They are basically for Sri Lanka.
This is where people, snakes, and weather interact. During the rainy season, the water could be all the way up to here. You see, some snakes don't like water, they don't like rain, so they're gonna curl up right here, right where you would put your foot when you go into the outhouse in the middle of the night. Mrs. Abewik Rama is counting her blessings. She had an accidental encounter.
A little bit, you can still feel a little bit of pain.
This street snake charmer purposely puts himself in front of venom-dripping fangs.
We were actually wondering, where do snake charmers come from? And why do they do this, and how do they stay safe? That in and of itself is a fascinating story.
We've come 2 hours to the remote village of Kudagama, and this is Raja. And do your thing. The answer to the obvious question is
Yes, he's been bitten.
Where?
This.
Right there?
I had to be in the hospital for about a week. Everybody who does snake charming got bitten.
Raja's dangerous family business is so ancient, it's mentioned in the Bible.
That's how I live and that's how I maintain my snakes.
Until recently, they were still relying on these magical snake bite stones.
And you believe it sucks the poison out?
I'm so happy that this antivenom is available now. I was played a role by handing over snakes.
They have Raja collect local snakes because antivenom works best when it's local. A cobra in India has very different venom than the same species in neighboring Sri Lanka.
When there's a sudden rain, after the rain, you'll see more snakes coming out.
But today, there is no rain. Most wild cobras are hiding.
There is a bit of show business here. Snakes don't have what we know as a sense of hearing. They don't have ears, but they can feel vibrations, basically any kind of vibration.
They feel vibration, they feel movement. It is more entertaining when you have music with the dancing of the snake. So I want to make it more elaborate for people to see.
Behind me is the Sigiriya Rock Fortress. The human part of the structure dates back to the 5th century AD right here in Sri Lanka. It's about 1,200 feet. You have to climb all the way to the top. What do you say? Let's go. Anuradhapura is one of the ancient capitals of Sri Lanka. It dates back to 5th century BC. We've come here to talk to the monks who take care of the sacred shrine because there's a story that connects the Buddha, the cobra, and the weather. This monk tells me he meditates for 5 hours every day. I didn't catch his name, but he had a great story to tell. A story that's inscribed in stone. While meditating under a tree, the Buddha was caught up in a massive thunderstorm. Lasted 7 whole days. The king of the serpents found the Buddha, extended his hood like an umbrella. He protects him from the rain, putting his hood up. This Mukalinda story is why the snake is sacred here. Despite a 30-year civil war between the mostly Buddhist Sinhalese and the mostly Hindu Tamil people, this is also a Hindu nation. This Hindu man is on a pilgrimage on foot to worship a god that has many heads and followed by many religions. Some call him Katadagama. We found his shrine in the city of the same name. These folks have been waiting in line for hours to worship and offer to the Katadagama six-headed god back here. You can see clearly there are cobras protecting this god on each side. You see that with many of the gods here. It is a festival atmosphere. Monkeys make out like bandits with all the fruit offered to the gods here. This is a place where Hindus and Buddhists dance together on the same dry dust. At least part of this is people coming here trying to end the drought.
That's true, and they will ask to bring them rain. A preacher will preach using different language to the god, saying that this person help him out because he is asking for this.
So how do they know if their wish is fulfilled? Well, if they're wishing for wetter weather, it hasn't come yet. In the US, we may have the groundhog to see into the future to predict the coming season. Here,
they have the burning coconut.
If it is broken to equal parts, that means their wishes will be fulfilled.
So basically, if we see a lot of half coconuts in there, the drought may be over.
That's true.
We're driving through the island nation of Sri Lanka with Palita here. He is our driver, and coming up after this break, you're drinking a cup of weather when you drink a cup of tea.
This is where your tea comes from. It's also where many people get bitten by venomous snakes. We will take you there. Then, catch yet another big snake in the house.
Here he comes, sir.
And are you brave enough for the SnakeStorm virtual reality experience? Scan this code on your screen right now, and I will put you in a plastic box with a wild hissing cobra, if that's the kind of thing you're into. Stay with us. It's a blazing hot Saturday afternoon.
Turn left.
We are speeding off to another emergency call.
It's nice and warm, so it's going to be highly, highly active.
Snake in the house.
On a hot day like this, it's going to be extremely agitated.
The family tells us it's a cobra.
The most important thing is human safety first, then second comes the safety of the snake.
Remember, we've already caught one big cobra.
Oh, my, looking for rats.
Whoa, whoa, whoa. A little venomous snake, too.
Wow. Look at the fangs. Look at that. Look at the venom.
This is the same kind of call.
Let's go check it out.
Our team is led by anti-venom producer Roy Maliapa.
It's a rat snake.
There it is. A big, fat, male rat snake.
Here he comes, sir. Get bitten.
As the nervous family watches, Roy pulls the snake from the woodpile.
So they didn't know if this was venomous or non-venomous. We just came running.
We came running because we were told that there was a snake.
Today, our catch is non-venomous.
But look at the coloration. It almost looked like a cobra. We have a children. We have a mother. We have so many young children. What's going to happen if this was a cobra today? We would have had an emergency.
But we are about to take you into one of the most dangerous places where venomous snakes bite all the time. A place you may not expect.
It's tutti, Auntie. Thank you. This cup of tea is actually concentrated human labor. It's also basically a cup full of weather. Let me show you how that is.
This is where your tea comes from. Sprawling tea plantation. Set up in just the right weather environment.
In the rainy season, we can get a rich harvest.
It comes more in the rainy season. You get more tea.
Because this shoot part growing up very quickly and very faster than other season.
Does that change the taste of the tea?
Yeah.
Turns out, warm weather tea tastes more bitter than the same plant grown in cooler weather.
So you're drinking a cup of weather when you drink a cup of tea.
Take a look at this plantation worker's feet. That's a snake bite risk.
Is she picking specific leaves, or is it just any leaf on the plant?
No, only younger leaves. Because these younger leaves give good taste and good aroma.
This is one of those things not many Americans think about when we're drinking our $1 large cup of iced tea from the fast food restaurant. This is where it actually comes from, a field with usually hundreds of workers picking the tops of these plants. They're not looking at the ground, where their normally bare feet could step right on a venomous snake each and every time they move. This is life and death here, part of the cost of a cup of tea. Around the world, as many as 2.5 million people are bitten by venomous snakes each year. About 100,000 will die. The difference between life and death is anti-venom and how fast you can find it.
We have some medical officer for our fields. We carry to the general hospital.
The nearest hospital to this remote tea estate is 1 hour away on bumpy roads. All that time, the tea workers' breathing is shutting down. Venom is attacking vital systems, nerves, blood, muscles. Right now, Roy's team is working with a major teaching hospital to produce the first anti-venom specifically for the snakes of Sri Lanka. When workers are out there in the hot fields when there's just been a major rainstorm, snakes come closer to humans and they bite. On a normal day, tea picking ends like this in the drying trough.
Using normal lab from the fan.
The process of producing some of the finest tea in the world dries out so much rainwater by the time it gets here that Premalata, the woman that you saw in the field, she can only produce at her top speed about 5 teacups worth every single day. 5 teacups in one day, and that process is not without its
danger. As I said, all part of the hidden cost deep brewed into your next cup of tea. With that, we are moving on. We're racing through the early evening here in central Sri Lanka. Here's a map to actually show you where we're going. We're trying to get to this section right in the middle of the jungle where 2 national parks are separated by a highway. We're trying to get to that highway right as the sun is setting because something incredible happens almost every evening there.
It's a mother and
father and baby?
Yeah, babies.
Mother and baby.
Mother and baby. And what's the other one?
They're both females.
All coming
this way. Quiet.
There's barely any light here, but our camera was able to capture the moment.
Follow me.
There, the trumpets.
We'd be able to run.
He saw us. How cool is that? We just got about 20 feet away from wild elephants and got the heck out of there when they started turning around towards us.
Acting on another tip, our team rolled towards an isolated garbage dump just after sunset. Wild elephant there too. Luckily, she didn't charge at us, but this deadly Russell's viper did. We got out of there because that Russell's viper has a spring action. We do not mess around with that. That is deadly serious. Coming up right after this break.
I've identified 18 different species of snake on the golf course.
So people tell me you're the self-taught snake wrangler of this community.
Well, people tell all sorts of stories.
Welcome back to Sri Lanka, where there is a very different kind of traffic jam than you'd find in the US.
The Elephant Express is just some kids on a flatbed truck and a jumbo-sized passenger. That's the kind of roadway congestion we had to fight to make it down this road on our way to a beautiful golf course near Sri Lanka's Victoria Dam back there. The Mahawali Ganga, or Great Sandy River, stretches for 208 miles throughout Sri Lanka from the Bay of Bengal, bringing water all over this country. But as you can see, the longest river in the country is very low right now because we're in a period of drought. But when the rain does come, it comes in earnest and the snakes come out. Every snapshot you see here, every snake popped up somewhere on the residential golf course popular with Western expats. So people tell me you're the self-taught snake wrangler of this community.
Well, people tell all sorts of stories.
We came here to track down Michael Morley.
I'm the guy that catches the snakes, yeah.
All kinds of mean snakes.
Four that I would class as seriously venomous. That's the cobra, the Russell's viper.
And the crate.
The common crate, which is also, of course, found in India.
And number four, the one that just got its own anti-venom.
I mentioned the hunter's viper, did I?
An hour and a half from here, a hospital and a nonprofit are testing a first-of-its-kind hump-nose anti-venom.
Yes, it's a nasty, serious bite. You would be hospitalized with it.
It also works against other snakes here.
I've identified 18 different species of snake on the golf course.
For decades, Mr. Morley worked as a nurse manager assisting with surgeries in the UK.
I'm sometimes consulted about medical matters here as well as snakes.
Michael's not a professional snake wrangler. He does this for fun and to help his neighbors.
In my opinion, there seems to be a definite relationship between the rain and snakes.
The more rainwater in the river, the more snakes he'll find.
And then, of course, these snakes do tend to come back up onto the golf course.
When Michael catches a snake, it sometimes goes to the AVRI Serpentarium so they can collect the venom and turn it into a local anti-venom. But he lives so far away that sometimes he just relocates the fanged menace.
If they have a snake, they call me, and I come and I just take them away and put them in the jungle. It's not a big issue.
But snake bite is. Around 100,000 people die each year because they don't have access to a hospital with cheap and local anti-venom. Looks like that could change in the near future.
The anti-venom traps the venom.
We saw in the hospital that it seems to be working with a handful of patients, but this is in the very early stages.
Yes.
It's not just this jungle that's full of deadly snakes. No, this is happening in many parts of the developing world. The plan is to get this pilot program up and running here in the next 2 years, then spread it worldwide after that, saving tens of thousands of lives each and every year.
This country needs it very badly.
This country, this one, these two, even this one. Yeah, zoos and collectors keep exotic snakes in the U.S., so what happens to help families here can also save lives where you live. These families really need a new medicine, but they also need rain that has been scarce lately.
And they will ask to bring them rain.
Remember that ancient ritual asking the gods for a storm? Well, it looks like it may have worked. For the first time since we arrived, there it was. An actual snake storm. Perfect opportunity to collect some reptiles.
We don't do this to show off how great we are. We do this because we know there's a need for a life-saving drug.
Those rainstorms are short-lived and unpredictable, but the one thing you can guarantee here is the next time it rains, snake bite victims will head to the hospital. For our entire team here in Sri Lanka, I'm Dave Malkoff. Thanks for joining us. We will see you next time.